Welcome, everyone, to this afternoon's Colts Chat Kickoff Edition, as we are now 2 days away from kicking off the season. I am Larra Overton, excited to be joining you guys this afternoon as we have a number of special guests joining us throughout our kickoff event. We have a highly anticipated 2020 season. And before we bring in our first of those special guests today, Chris Ballard, we want to give you an exciting look inside your 2020 Indianapolis Colts.
Have a lot of faith in this group because you were chosen for a reason.
The Colts and Chris Ballard kicked the doors off their draft.
Michael Pittman,
Jonathan Taylor,
DeForest Buckner.
With him and Darius Leonard, they have a powerhouse defense.
A lot of weapons for Phillip Rivers to work
this
with.
This is going to take this football team, and it's going to catapult there in the AFC South.
Be here now. If we can learn how to do this as a team at a higher level than we've ever done it before, we have that kind of talent that we can go all the stinking way.
We're going to go where you want to go. But you have to lead it.
Coach, whatever you need,
I got you.
That's it, man. That's it.
Give everything you got, man.
Go, go, go. That's it.
I closed my eyes, and what did I think about? I'm thinking about you. After 6 months of hard discipline, the sacrifices, hard work, that moment where you just stand there and say, I'm the best in the world. Who can finish it out? Who can finish it?
I'm not sure that anything could get me more fired up than that video right there. I've seen it at least a dozen times and I still get chills. I want to welcome in our general manager, Chris Ballard. You heard him there addressing the team as we prepare for the season. And now, Chris, it is here.
Yes. Thank you, Laura. Thanks for having me.
Well, just give us a bit of an indication of, you know, all of the buildup that there was. You guys went through, you know, such a tumultuous offseason, just so much unprecedented. Now we're finally to this point, just your outlook, your expectation as we get ready to kick off on Sunday afternoon.
No, look, we're excited. It's been a great camp. You guys have worked their tails off, worked hard, and you know, gone through the ups and downs. It's been 7 weeks now we've been here, and then navigating the protocols, you know, that we've had to navigate. You know, I'm very proud of the organization, of everything they did to put us in a situation to be here now, where, you know, we're ready to kick off football. And, you know, that's a credit to, you know, Dave Hammer, Pete Ward, Jeff Brown, guys behind the scenes, you don't get to see or hear about very often, but these guys led the charge of making sure everything was in place. So, but you know, ready to go, ready to kick it off. We've had a great 7 weeks of work, and feel good about where we're going.
We know that you guys, usually you and Coach Wright collectively, have a bit of a message or a mantra to start out the season. Kind of, what is that, you know, command that you have given? Maybe what is, we talk about, you know, the climb each and every year. What was your message there? We saw a bit of it there when you guys were addressing the team there within training camp.
Look, our Frank is outstanding when it comes to, you know, his vision of how he wants the team to perform. And his big talk this year was on, you know, we want to be the best team for this city. And that's not only being a great team on the field that our fans are going to be proud of, but also one that makes a difference off the field, that really creates change off the field. And we think we can do both. We got the right group of people, the right players, right staff. We think we can do great things both on and off the field this year, and staying focused on, you know, the each and every day of getting better, you know, really pushing each other. Nothing different from in the past, but we really wanted to dial in on every single day, competing and getting better.
One of the things you're undoubtedly going to have to do over the course of any season is adapt and overcome a bit of adversity. Given what you guys had over these past few months, the way that your team adapted to all the protocols, the procedures, they had to operate on Zoom for most of the OTA period. You had no preseason games. How proud are you of how your coaching staff, how your players have adapted to prepare themselves and get ready, given just how unprecedented the circumstances were?
Well, you know, look, everybody's got problems. You know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't. People, at the end of the day, they want to see the result. So we have to find a way to get done the work we needed to get done. And they were outstanding. We have a bunch of good teachers on this coaching staff. They found a different way to teach. And then a credit to our players, because they came in great physical shape. Our strength coach staff, led by Rusty Jones, did a tremendous job making sure he was tracking everything they were doing. And then they bought in. They understand what's at stake, and the commitment level that is needed to get it done. And so no matter what the obstacles were this offseason, you know, all 32 teams were dealing with the same thing. And it's going to be who handled dealing with, you know, the different circumstances the best, or be the teams that are successful.
Well, Chris, I'm looking at the clock right now. I know you have a busy afternoon because you've got to get out to the practice field. I can see the comments coming in. I'm sure you can as well. How many people just appreciate your hopping on and what is such a busy week for you. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us.
Well, no, thank y'all. And look, you got two of the all-time greats of this franchise coming on to speak to you today, and consider – you know, they are the gold standard of what we are trying to do. And we model a lot after the type of players we look for, the type of men that both Jeff Saturday and Reggie Wayne are. So feel fortunate. But look forward to seeing all y'all through the season, and go Colts.
Chris, thank you so much. And
thank
you. Mentioned it. We're bringing in Jeff Saturday. We're bringing in Reggie Wayne. And first, I want to introduce six-time Pro Bowler, All-Pro, and certainly the catalyst for the loudest chants we ever hear or we ever heard within the RCA Dome and then within Lucas Oil Stadium. You all know it. I know you're playing it, Reggie, Reggie, over and over in your head. here is a look at some of the most memorable moments from Reggie Wayne's Colts career.
Looks for the quick throw, throws to Reggie, touchdown! Reggie Wayne! Oh, yes, 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 yes! Throws one downfield, Reggie's there, got it to 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown! Reggie Wayne! Takes the snap, sets up, looks, he throws, caught by Reggie, did he get it? Yes!
Give it to him!
Yes, yes, he got it!
Reggie, welcome in, so great to have you. I'm hoping that you're hearing those Reggie chants. Is that what happens? Like you pull up to the bank and everyone's just like, Reggie, Reggie. Like I'm sure anywhere you go within Indianapolis, that's the greeting that you get.
And I love everything about it. I love it. I love it. I love it. Watching that highlight film, I'm looking for my helmet and shoulder pads. I'm so excited that football is back. Man, I can't get enough of those highlights. I love it.
We can't get enough of it either. Now, looking at this 2020 Colts roster, I know that you obviously you've worked as an analyst, so you can look at this kind of partially from that broadcaster breaking down as an analyst perspective, but then also, you know, a little bit of homerism in there too, being that this Colts season comes in with such high expectations. What do you like about the team that you see right now that they've put together? I know we have yet to face an opponent, but still we can make an estimation.
Well, I like everything that Chris Ballard and his scouting department has done. They're bringing some young guys, some young, hungry guys to come in and do it the Colts way. Chris mentioned about, you know, me and Jeff kind of being the standard. And we look at the guys before us that built the standard before us. So it's a domino effect. And the type of guys that he's bringing in there are guys that you want on your team. Just guys that are hungry. Just look at the receiver group, for example. Like, you know, a lot of these guys are second, third rounders and later, you know. So those guys are coming in hungry. You know that those guys will be more attentive and they'll listen. So I'm excited just to see this team play. They're being led by a future Hall of Famer in Phillip Rivers, which is kind of weird. But he is now a Colts guy. And I'm excited to see these guys come together and put it all into fruition.
Well, Reggie, I'm getting a couple of special messages right here to you. Stacy Muffler writes, I have a cafeteria full of fourth graders at Fortville Elementary that are excited to see Reggie. One is even wearing the number 87 jersey.
I appreciate it. Appreciate you guys. Stay tuned. I am happy that you guys are checking us out. And make sure you eat all your vegetables. Eat all of your vegetables.
Reggie, how cool is it for you to see? Obviously, when you were playing, you would see, I mean, hundreds of those 87 jerseys up in the stands, but we see them even still, and we see them on some of those youngest fans, you know, those even new and growing Colts fans. How cool is it to see just your legacy just extending across these generations of Colts fans?
Oh, it's awesome. It's awesome. Every time I, you know, since I retired, when I see a guy wearing one or a lady wearing one, I go up to him and I say, thank you. Thank you for keeping me alive, you know, but I remember it was one point in time and early in my career where I didn't see that very many of them. And I was wondering, I'm saying to myself, like, what am I doing wrong? You know, I need more 87 jerseys out there. But then as the years went on, you know, a lot of people started wearing them and it just puts a smile on your face. It really does. It tells you that you did something right. And, you know, and for me, you know, I try to do everything beyond just playing football. I tried to make, I tried to make outside the football feel special as well. So it's putting everything together and just seeing people wearing the jerseys. I believe that's a check mark for what I've tried to do in my career and outside of it.
Well, as we heard Chris mention, you know, the gold standard that you and Jeff and so many of your teammates set, one of those influences and a testament to that is your leadership, of course, in this Indianapolis community, then also your leadership in the locker room. And you took T.Y. Hilton under your wing, and he has been so candid to speak about how much he learned from your leadership and that now he carries so much of what you taught him as he's now the leader of that wide receiving unit. He took that torch from you, you know, bringing along guys like Zach Pascal, Paris Campbell, and now Michael Pittman Jr. and Desmond Patman, the newest guys into that room. just tell me how special your relationship with T.Y. is, how proud you are, not only of the player that he is and what he's been able to do in his career, but also the type of leader he is now, a second season captain for this team.
You know, I am so excited to watch T.Y. and everything that he's able to do on the field and stuff. Him being from Miami, we know a lot of the same people. He actually played at FIU, which at the time his head coach was Mario Cristobal, who is a University of Miami alum, and I know very well. So before T.Y. even walked in the building, I talked to his college coach, you know, Mario Cristobal. He said, take care of T.Y. I say, say no more, you know. So, you know, I still remember the first day T.Y. walked in into the meeting room. I had an empty seat next to me, and I said, hey, young fella, sit right here, you know what I mean? And he sat down next to me. But, you know, after that point on, I didn't have to say anything to T.Y. T.Y. was just asking me a ton of questions. People that know me, teammates that know me, they know I'm a heavy note taker. And he brought out his notebook, and he was writing and writing and writing. He don't have the very best penmanship, but he was writing. And but, you know, T.Y., he was a student of the game from day one. He wanted to get better. He wanted to figure out how to do different things. He wanted to learn how to read coverages. You know, so it's great just watching T.Y. grow and grow each year, and seeing him, you know, develop into the leadership role. You know, it was something like, it was the same thing for me, because when I got there, you know, I had a Marvin Harrison already in a receiver room. I already had a Peyton Manning, who was a quarterback. I had a Jeff Saturday, who was a vocal leader as well. So, you know, I kind of had guys to kind of, you know, build that stage for me. So I was able to sit back for some years and watch. And then all of a sudden I was put into that role. And it's not a, you know, being a leader, you know, not only of a position, but just of a team, it's not always the easiest thing. It's not something that you can really take a class for, you know? So, just sitting back and watching and seeing, you know, T.Y. develop into being that leader, it's outstanding.
I want to remind everyone, too, that we are taking your questions. We want this to be interactive. So any questions that you have for Reggie and for Jeff, when we bring him in just a few minutes, put those right there in the Q&A function. I'm going to read a few that are directed specifically to you, Reggie. We have Gary Bridwell wants to know. He said, I've sat in Section 103 for 35 years now. Thank you, Gary, for that and your loyalty to the Indianapolis Colts. He said, we embraced Marvin and then you with the Reggie, Reggie, Reggie chants. What was the importance of, after a touchdown, going to Section 103 with the signs and the chants for you?
You know, it meant everything. It just kind of happened, I guess you would say. I'm all about, you know, getting fans involved. You know, my biggest thing was, every Sunday, you know, we all have problems. We all have things going on in our lives. And I knew that those 3 hours were a time where whatever you had going on, you can kind of get away from. So, and sit down and watch football and enjoy it. So I was all about, you know, the fans, getting them going. So I just wanted just to keep them hype. I wanted to keep them going and some, you know, just after I kept doing it and doing it and doing it. And then all of a sudden turns, you know, into Reggie's corner and things like that, you know, so I embraced it. It was awesome, you know, seeing the signs, just getting everybody excited. You know, I'm upbeat. I love to laugh. I love to smile. And if I can get, you know, Colts fans to do the same, you know, it was exciting to me. So It was crazy. I wanted to score there every time, you know, on that side, but it didn't happen. But since I knew that was going to be a tough situation for me, I just wanted to make sure I go over there before every game and get everybody excited.
Yeah. How'd it go when you went and got in Peyton's ear and you're like, that corner right there, you're telling him where to throw it, right? That probably didn't go over very well. He's probably,
you know, it didn't go over well at all.
Well, you mentioned your relationship with the fans, and before our event even got started, I got a special request to get a shout out from you to Melanie Moses. She claims to be your biggest fan. I think a lot of people claim to be your biggest fan, but Melanie's certainly right up there. And she has just battled through some life-threatening health issues lately, but She even named her dog Reggie, and she calls him Reggie, Reggie. That's how she refers to him day in and day out. So just get a quick special shout out to Melanie there from you.
Melanie Moses, I appreciate your support. Thank you for everything. And thank you for naming your dog Reggie. You know, I get that quite often. Yeah, it's a lot of animals out there is named Reggie. So I take it as a compliment. At first, I wasn't too kind of it, but now I want every animal to be named Reggie. I enjoy it. Thank you, Melanie.
That is awesome. I'd imagine there are probably a lot of Reggie references, especially around Indiana, between yourself and Pacers great Reggie Miller. That's got to be a favorite, a very common name, I'm sure, that people bestow not only on their pets, but kids as well. I know I've known a couple of kids named Reggie after you. So going to take a few more questions here as we work through some of these. Let's see. Daniel Zhu wants to know expectations for our offense this year. Do you think our running game or passing game makes a bigger impact?
Well, being that we have a pretty solid offensive line, and me knowing Frank Wright and what he wants to do, I'm going to say we're going to have a great – I think both running and passing will be pretty effective, but I think we're going to focus more on running the ball, and then hopefully that can open up the pass, makes it easier for our young receivers, makes it easier for Phillip. You know, I know that's kind of tough coming from a wide receiver, but I understand. I get it. I get
– You're a team player.
Yeah, I'm a team player. I know it works off of each other, you know. So I think we're going to focus more on running, and then hopefully that'll open up the pass.
Well, that is fitting that you mentioned the run game, because we know that starts up front with the offensive line, and we want to bring in one of your great teammates, the six-time Pro Bowler, a fellow Super Bowl champion, two-time All-Pro, certainly a fan favorite. Let's get a look at one of the most memorable Jeff Saturday moments.
Coming out of college, Jeff Saturday was listed as too small and too slow in many NFL ranks. But what he did have can't always be measured.
He's a player who makes everyone around him better.
Saturday signed with the Colts in 1999 and developed a unique bond with Peyton Manning.
He was very dependable. He was accountable. You knew he was always going to answer the bell every single Sunday. I never had to worry about getting snaps from other centers, because I knew number 63 was going to be at center in front of me every single Sunday.
All right, ready to go!
They don't want no part of that.
But like any friendship, there were occasional fireworks.
Hey, quit calling the plays, all right?
We got to run the ball. Wait, six down.
We need pass, watch, watch.
Run it down.
Just play
center. We run it down.
Yeah, Jeff, okay, so we will.
His incredible will to win is what transcends everything else about him.
And that was never more evident than the AFC Championship game against the Patriots.
They give us to Dominic off the left side. Cuts back right, got to the goal line, but didn't get in.
That's when I got fumbled.
Touchdown! They say the Colts got it! Yep, the Patriots thought they had it. Jeff Saturday got it.
And then came the block.
Manning will give it to Joseph right up the middle. Touchdown!
Dedicated husband, father, and teammate.
I'm just extremely proud of him for his great career, his durability, his level of commitment.
We welcome in now Colts great Jeff Saturday. Jeff, what kind of emotions do you get? I know you've seen that video over and over, but that one from your Ring of Honor induction, what kind of emotion does that bring back?
Yeah, I can't see it too much. You know what I mean? Dudes like Reggie, they get that kind of stuff all the time. For these old offensive linemen, I don't get many highlights like that. You know, I get a little chills every time I see it. Makes a man feel good about himself. You know what I mean? When you got Reggie and everybody's chanting your name every Sunday, all those kind of things. Most folks only say my name because it's a weekday. You know what I mean? So I'm just trying to hold it down. That's the best I can do.
Well, one of the moments I know that we get the most reaction from is always see you going face-to-face there with your quarterback, exchanging some words with Peyton Manning. Reggie, give me a little insight into what those moments were like there on the sideline there.
First of all, I'm kind of upset that every time I watch Jeff, because Jeff wants to run the ball instead of pass. Like, what's up, bro? Like, we all right over here. No, but, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, it's football, man, and you love everything about it. Guys are going to be, you know, saying a lot of stuff to each other. Guys are going to – you're going to put all of your emotions into it because we know how much time and effort that we put in with practice and preparation. So, you know, if I won't say anything goes, but a lot of stuff goes on in between those lines, and we understand that when we're out there.
Jeff, does that just make you laugh, looking back and watching that?
Absolutely. And listen, what Wheezy just said is so true. I mean, you know what I mean? The greatest part about our team was – we could really all speak to each other like that. And it was never personal. And I think the reason it wasn't personal was because everybody understood how much each of us were putting into this as individuals and as teammates. And so everybody knew we were coming to work with that, you know, lunch pail type mentality. And so, you know, you may get upset with people, you may get frustrated with each other, but you know, truthfully, the love we had for each other is what carried us on. We're all going to fight. We're all going to get upset. We're never going to always see it the same way. But when the whistle's in, man, we walk off, we know we're going arm in arm because we want to do this again the next day.
Yep.
Well, one of the things that's always fun is to see when you guys get back together, when you're able to get out on the field, Ring of Honor celebrations. And that's one thing that Chris Ballard has talked about, is when he sees you guys, that particular era, that those rosters that you guys were a part of, those championship teams, he looks and just sees such good dudes on and off the field for what you represent as being part of the Horseshoe. And I have a fitting question here from Robert Glassburn to each of you. And he wants to know, what do you think about the group of men in the current Colts locker room? Do they stand up to the level of character that was set by guys like yourself and Coach Dungy? Because that's certainly been a point of emphasis that Chris Ballard has put in terms of building his rosters here in Indy.
Yeah, I would say absolutely. I mean, you know, if you look at what Chris and Frank and the entire organization from Ursay down, it looks like us, you know what I mean? And you know, I flash back to, you know, those days of 99 and on, and it was like every time we added somebody, we didn't need to worry about were they going to fit in our locker room. When they came in, we were all like-minded. We were all about the business of football. We were about team first, all of those things that now, you know, that now go along with the Philip Rivers and the Big Q and all the guys that you see. And then flip it over with Leonard, like the freak, like those guys would have fit in our locker room. I mean, each and every one of those guys would have walked right in and you'd have felt comfortable with them, right? They're guys who earn it. They're about it. They're about the business of football and they're about the community they live in. That's all you had to be was a Colt, man. Don't be a distraction. Don't screw it up for the rest of us, right? Like at the end of the day, that was what we always talked about. And we were self-governed. And I feel like that's what Frank has put on this football team. And so absolutely, I think what Chris and Frank have both done, they have brought guys in that are accountable, they're responsible, and they're about team first. And that'll win in the NFL.
Yeah, and to feed off of what Jeff said, you know, I had Frank Wright as my receiver coach for a year. So he was able to sit there and watch the locker room grow. We knew as players, you know, we were family. We was around each other more than we were our original family, you know? So like Jeff said, don't mess it up. Don't mess it up. Don't be that guy and everything will be okay. So we always took pride into, you know, knowing each other's families, knowing each other's kids. We were a close group. So Frank got accustomed. He witnessed that. He knows the Colts way. And I'm sure that, you know, he's bringing in the right guys, him and Chris Ballard, they're bringing in the right type of guys in there to continue to follow that mold.
Yeah. Hey, and let me add this too. The family aspect that Wheezy's talking about, when I walked off the field every Sunday, you know, his mom, his pops, they were hugging me up, right? Like my family hugging them up, right? When we leave on Sunday, you know, we're all going to the same restaurants. We did all of that together. And so not only did you feel it for your boy, for your teammate, you felt it for his family, right? When you saw somebody get paid or get a big contract or have a big, you know, a successful year that you know they were going to use to step up, you were fired up not only for them, but for their family. And so I think all of those things lead into developing a team that will be sustainable and can grow and the community can be proud of. And I agree, man. I think what Wheezy just said is perfect.
Well, you guys mentioned bringing the right guys in. You both referenced Philip Rivers. I know Reggie said a little bit earlier, still kind of weird to see him in the blue and white, right? Absolutely. After going against him for so many years. But Jeff, we talked about this on the podcast. I want to go back to it and get Reggie's thoughts as well. But what did you see in going against a guy like Philip Rivers when he's on an opposing sidelines that you respected about him and somebody that you could see that's the type of teammate you want to have that now is so exciting for us as the Colts to have him representing the horseshoe?
Incredible competitor. I mean, you know, like playing with torn ACL against us. I mean, I remember, you know, all of our fans getting after him and, you know, goes back and we've all heard about how he, you know, he chews people out ever saying a curse word, you know, so he's going back and forth with our fans. And, but you love that competitive nature, right? You love guys that on Sunday, they're there, they're all in, they're going to try to make the guys around them better. And I think that's what you've seen from Phil for all those years. And so you can always tell the guys who they are true ballers, right? They are pro. And that's always been him. He's never going to back down. He's never going to look for an excuse. He's never going to look for a way out. Even if it's on him, he'll own it, you know, and if it's not on him, he'll own it. And those are the kind of guys you want leading a football team. And so it is weird to see him in that horseshoe because I saw him for so many years, you know, as a Charger. But, man, you know, how lucky are we to have a guy like that leading our squad this year?
Yeah, for me, you know, I just remember every time we would play the Chargers, it was always, you know, here come this dude again. You know,
like, yes.
Yeah, it was like, here this dude come again. Like, because you know he's not going to quit. He's always, you know, as Jeff said, he's an ultimate competitor. He's going to give you everything he got. And you know it's not going to be over until it's all zeros on that scoreboard. So, I mean, I had the luxury of meeting Philip in a Pro Bowl one time, you know, and I shook his hand. I tried to break every bone in his hand. But man, it's, I mean, you know, for a young offense that the Colts have, it is such a delight to have a leader like Philip Rivers in that huddle, in that locker room. He's accomplished so much, you know, future Hall of Famer. He'll get those guys in the right direction. But weird is definitely an understatement. I even saw when you guys posted him in his uniform. It's just funny to see him in it. But you know, I'm excited that he's a Colt, and I'm sure he has plenty left in the tank, and he can lead these guys.
Jeff, you mentioned the game that he played with that torn ACL. Well, I had a conversation with Philip right when he signed, and he said that he actually remembered in that game when he was running out of the tunnel. He was shouting at the fans, yelling, "I'll be back," and how ironic and fitting that is now that, and indeed, he's back, but in a different fashion than any of us probably could have predicted.
Absolutely.
It's cool to have him reflect on that. Yeah, I want to get to a couple of quick questions here that we have coming in the Q&A. Jeff, this is fitting, of course, because recently we lost a legend of our organization in Howard Mudd, and Elizabeth Owens just wants to ask, certainly fitting to take a couple of moments to celebrate his legacy and the impact that he had. She asked, could you just share some memories of Howard Mudd that you shared here in Indy?
Oh, listen, the greatest NFL coach in history. I mean, you know, when you talk about O-line coaches, man, there's not one that's even comparable in my mind. This guy, he drove guys to greatness, and he didn't care if it was like me, an undrafted rookie free agent, or if it's Tarik Glenn, you know, a first round pick. He treated us all the same, and he was going to get the very most out of each and every one of us. It's crazy because literally 3 days before his accident, Reggie, a bunch of us, it was like 25 or 26, we're on a Zoom call together. Yep. And he was actually sitting on his motorcycle and talking about Tierlink, another one of our great coaches that we just lost, and how that relationship was so valuable to him. And I think that was truly what differentiated Howard from other coaches, is personally he impacted my life so much more than he could have ever as a coach. And he made me the player I was. And so, you know, I tell you all the time, my career was better than I ever deserved. But as a man, he always asked me, about my kids, about my marriage, about, hey, how are you living? What's it, you know, what else is going on in your life? It wasn't just about football. And I think that's what I appreciated so much with him. You know, I called him the mad scientist because he was always, you know, grabbing his hair and screaming. And, you know, he was that guy. He could curse you like nobody's business. And in the same sentence, tell you how much he loved you. You know what I mean? And so you never knew really where he was coming from. But he could take it too. You know, he dished it out. But if you went back at him, and I did many times, and it was, again, it was one of those things where he appreciated honesty and he appreciated guys who loved what they did. Man, we are going to miss him. He was just a very unique man, and one that I know, you know, it didn't matter what position you played. Everybody respected so much of how much he gave to that football team. And we're going to miss the heck out of him. And surely his wife and his kids, man, they had a great one in him.
I want to stick with the offensive line conversation because we're getting a number of questions just about, you know, the pillars of this current offensive line, especially when you look at guys like Quentin Nelson and Anthony Costanzo. Well, we have this question here of how much is this offensive line maybe reminiscent of what you played with, of the contingent of guys, those five guys, those, you know, four other guys that you lined up with? And what do you really like about this offensive line going into 2020 with the talent and the cohesiveness that there is there?
Oh man. I mean, this line is you know, if they're not the best in the NFL right now, they're one of the top two or three. You know, even Kelly, you know, just getting that contract and, you know, being solidified now as a Colt long term, and congratulations to him. But all of those guys from Costanzo in and you know, obviously Big Q, you know, he gets all the attention and is well deserved, you know, being the pick that he was and coming in and dominating the NFL the way he has. But it's the mentality that they play with. I think they're actually more physical than we were. You know, when you look at the way they play and the style they play behind their pads. They are a very physical football team, and they love it. You know, I mean, you can tell they enjoy it, right? They have a nastiness about them that I appreciate. We were probably more geared towards pass blocking and for Peyton, knowing kind of the way he was going to be than we were. So it's two different groups, right? But man, they are fantastic. I love watching them. I love the, you know, there's some things that get out that are from audio that most people can't hear that I get to hear. And I love it, man. I love the mic'd up portions of these linemen. Like they are truly a nasty group, man. And I am all for it. So I am more than pleased with what Ballard has done with this group and look forward. And, you know, obviously they all stay healthy. This is what you ride in this football team. I love Phil. I love all the outside guys. But this offensive line, it takes so much pressure off of your defense and other areas of your football team when you can control that front. Man, I am looking forward to what they can do this year.
Reggie, we heard Jeff say that, you know, typically, you know, the receivers get a lot of the attention. How much credit do you give back to your O-line?
Oh, everything. Everything. A lot of people, you know, it's funny, you know, a lot of people always talk about, you know, when I played with Peyton and stuff and how he controlled everything. I say, look, yeah, he did do a lot of stuff, but Jeff Saturday had to start it first. Jeff had to start it first. It all started with Jeff Saturday. Man, like, there's nothing that can be done successfully without our offensive line. Everything goes through them. They control everything. And as I mentioned earlier, the run takes care of the pass or vice versa. Man, like, you know, as we call them, the big uglies, man, they don't get a lot of the action, you know, a lot of the glory. But those guys, they really, you know, get after it every play. So without people like Jeff Saturday, people won't be chanting Reggie, you know what I'm saying? You know, so, man, you know, they deserve everything. But a lot of times, I know there were times where, when you know, the offensive line, when I played with Jeff and Tark and those guys, they didn't want the glory. They wasn't going to get the glory. If any of them got any glory, there might be something that happens to them a little later.
That's right. Lots of fines. Lots of fines came my way.
Well, we always hear Chris Ballard say it starts up front. And as you guys talk about, Reggie, you talk about those unsung heroes. We want to bring in some of our frontline workers. We have IU Health and some of the staff members at Riley Hospital for Children who are going to join us. They are enjoying some lunch right now. We want to put them up on the screen. We want to just thank you all for being our heroes, for everything that you have done, for being here on the front lines of this pandemic, working tirelessly, sacrificing so much. I know you guys have a question that you want to pose to Jeff and Reggie, but first we just want to say thank you. We want to give you guys the applause because so much credit should go to you guys for keeping us safe, keeping us healthy, and all the sacrifices that you all make. So thank you so much. And then whenever you want to jump in with your question.
Hi, my name is Megan. I have a question for Jeff, actually. I work up on the Riley Burn Unit. First of all, thank you so much for everything you've done for you and our kids. Just really enjoy the B program, the Saturday lockers. But my question is, what made you so passionate about the burn population?
So my youngest son, Joshua, when he was I think he was just under a year old, or I'm sorry, just over a year old. And he was in that crawl walk phase, you know, doing that kind of thing. And he actually got in between the fireplace protector and our fireplace. And so he got his hands on the glass. And so he had second and third degree burns on his hands. And I remember my wife, Karen, called me. I was at work. Yeah, at practice, and had to leave and go to the hospital. And I remember getting down there and looking at the entire floor and just thinking to myself, it doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter. Nothing matters. Like that you can't do anything. Somebody has to stay here 24/7 with these kids. And, you know, one parent has to go with the other kids. And because we had two other children. And it just blew my mind. And I could not fathom how people can do this. And my wife is a physical therapist by trade. So she was changing his bandages and doing all those things at home. And I just told her flat out, I was like, listen, if I were by myself, there's no way. And so I could not be more grateful for each and every one of you guys. But you know, my heart is with our burn population, even with the camp and Hoosier Burn Camp that we do every year. Those are my folks, man, my people. And I so love what you guys do each and every day. And it is a lifelong journey for our burn survivors. And we know that, and it doesn't stop. And it's a continuous, and to watch these young kids grow up and then give back to the same community, my heart could not be any happier. And so I'm so grateful to you guys for what you're doing, for everybody there. Again, thank you guys so much for what you're doing during this pandemic and truly being the frontline workers and the true heroes, honestly, in our communities.
Thank you all so much for hopping on. Enjoy your lunch. Appreciate your taking time out of your busy day to share with us. Time for just a few more, a handful of questions. And I got one earlier today from Christy Mooney Schaefer. She's a veteran. She's also a survivor of 9/11. So I certainly wanted to be sure we made time for her question today. But this is to both Reggie and to Jeff, whoever wants to answer first. She asked, knowing what you know now, what advice would you have given 13-year-old Reggie or 13-year-old Jeff?
Man, for me, you know, that's funny. Me coming from, you know, New Orleans, Louisiana, it was tough, right? So I didn't have all the best equipment, all the top-notch, you know, opportunities. I would tell the 13-year-old Reggie just what my parents told me then: don't stop, don't quit,
that's right.
Just keep going, no matter what. I mean, man, I remember, you know, there were times where we were using a soccer ball for a basketball, we did what we had to do, but at the end of the day, we kept going. So I would tell the young Reggie just the same thing I would tell any young kid or any grown up, you know, don't stop, keep going. If whatever your vision is, whatever your dream is, they do come true. Keep going at it and go at it 100 miles per hour. And at the end of the day, see where it all lays out.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. You know, I think football as a game truly teaches perseverance, because it ain't all good days. And to what Reggie's saying, man, like where you are today doesn't dictate where you can be in 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. And so don't let the circumstances you're in right now define what your future looks like. And I, you know, even as coaching these past 6 or 7 years, I tell kids all the time when they tell me, I want to go play ball, I want to go do this. And I look at each and every one, I'm like, perseverance is going to be the key, right? Because the long-term grind will outdo talent if that talent doesn't want to work. You're going to have to work, but it ain't pretty. And it's not fun. You know, every day is not game day, right? It's the 5 days that you're working to get up to that game day. Those are the keys. And so understand that, you know, the beauty that you see on Sunday, there's a lot of ugliness to get there those 5 and 6 days leading up. Don't quit, man. There's no back down. There's no back down in this thing. And if you do, your dreams will come true. But so many people short side themselves. They don't want them 5 days, right? They don't want them 6 days of work, man. They love that Sunday. Sunday's good, right? But like Mar told me my first year, and I know he told Reg and everybody else, man, he's like, man, we do the game days for free. We get paid for practice, right? Like, understand that's real. That is the truth. Because Sundays, man, everything's good. Come those 6 days, though, you got to have that grind mentality.
You know, to piggyback off of what Jeff said, you know, one thing I always tell people to this day, you have to learn how to fight boredom.
That's right.
That's the biggest thing. You get bored all the time of practicing, doing the same things over and over and over. And you feel like, you know, you it comes a time where you don't put forth effort into it because it's you know, you're like, I did this yesterday. Or I did this today. You know, I'm going to do this tomorrow. We have to learn how to fight boredom. And once you learn how to do that and take, like Jeff said, those 5-6 days in between, when you start really focusing on that, then that payday, that game day, that's what's going to be extra special.
Yeah. Hey, listen, I love it because he just flashed in my mind. Tom Moore, our old offensive coordinator, used to tell us, there are no new routes and no new plays. You got to do it again. he would hit us with that every day. He's like, I'm not coming up with new plays. Yeah. I'm not getting Howard Mudd the same thing. We ain't going to do anything different. You better just work on your feet to get it right. Oh, my word. To Reggie's point, man, you would be like, come on. We got to be able to do – is there something we can bring? No. We're going to do the same plays over and over. That's how we're going to win, and that's real.
Yep.
Well, talking about those practice matchups, one of the conversations we had in the offseason, and this is a question we've gotten a lot, is on DeForest Buckner. And so that competition that we got to watch in camp between this O-line and D-line certainly has been epic. It's been awesome to see those guys competing head-to-head. Jeff, for you, Lawrence Owen asks, what makes DeForest Buckner so tough to block? If you were still playing, how would you approach blocking him?
Get him, Jeff.
Man, I'm glad I ain't. Okay, I take that back. I wish I was making that money, but blocking the same dudes I did back then. No, you know what? He is truly a fully developed D lineman. And you know, I saw some people when Chris made the trade to go up and get him, and I was so fired up about the trade. Because it usually takes defensive linemen a couple years to develop in the league. And what you're looking at is a guy really, truly, he's not even in his prime yet, right? He's building into his prime. But he's got that long reach. He's got a nice stab inside. He has very nice hand placement. He's got good leverage. He's got good snap in his hips. And so you'll see guys, he'll stonewall guys and be able to readjust and get rid of guys. And I think so many players you look at in the NFL now, they're one-way type guys. They're going to be really strong against the pass, but they're kind of average or below average versus the run. This is not this guy. This is a guy who you are fully comfortable any down, no matter when it's on the line, he will be that guy. And so I am so excited for what he's going to do for our defensive line and what that allows our outside pressure, because you got to deal with him, right? Like there's no way you're going to single block that cat all game. You're going to be sliding doubles to him, or you're going to be trying to do something with a back to chip him to help even an inside chip. So all of those things hopefully will help our other guys continue to thrive as well. But I am so fired up about that signing.
Just a couple of minutes and we're going to wrap things up. Reggie, I want to go to you because we've gotten a lot of questions about the young receivers, especially Michael Pittman Jr. What do you see in him? And then just all of these weapons that have been assembled for Phillip Rivers and the complement that Michael Pittman Jr. can provide alongside guys like T.Y., Zach Pascal, Paris Campbell.
You know what? This signing was big. Yeah, I'm going to tell you why it's big. Because this guy, I really believe, was one of the steals of the draft. His size, you know, or he can run a conversation with Chris Ballard. And I asked him, he enjoys practicing. He enjoys to listen. He takes coaching the right way. You know, this receiver group is special. It really is. It's a special group. Like I said earlier, it's a hungry group of guys. And these guys go in with the right attitude every day. They're being led by T.Y. Hilton, who I'm expecting to have a big year this year. But Mike, you know, Michael Pittman Jr., a lot of people compare him to me, which is great. You know, I'm all ears, I'm all eyes, I'm watching, and I'm hoping that he can come in and kind of take some of that pressure off of a T.Y. and off of a Paris Campbell. So it's a group, a young group on this team, but it's a big group. It's feisty. I'm excited to see what this group can do, and hopefully T.Y. can get these guys going in the right direction, which I know he's doing that. So it's one of those things where I'm excited for him. I want to see him go out there and perform at a high level. You got Phillip Rivers. You got a guy that's not going to quit. He's going to know all the paths, but know how to get it to you the way you want it, and as they say, a runner's ball. And so hopefully these guys can get off this weekend and do the things that they're capable of doing. So let's go. I'm about those receivers, Jeff. Let's get these guys.
Like,
man, my hair standing up on my arms right now. I want to see these guys. Just give me my helmet and my shoulder pads. I want to go out there with these guys.
Well, I want you to put on not your helmet and shoulder pads. I want you to put on your NFL analyst hat. Each of you guys have worked as broadcasters analyzing the NFL. I want you to assess from your perspective this 2020 Colts roster, what to expect this season, what you're most excited for about this squad as we wrap things up.
Go ahead first, Jeff.
Okay. I'll say this. So you saw the Chiefs last night. It's an excellent, excellent football team, right? They're built well. They got a ton of weapons. You saw their defense improve, and they're going to continue to get better. So how do you combat Mahomes and all the weapons you have? It's truly the way the Colts are built, right? Like offensive line, being able to slow things down, being able to grind it out, get first downs, move chains, and keep Mahomes in the offense on the sideline. I mean, that's true. And that's what teams used to do to us. It's how do you play complementary football? And I think the Colts are built for that, right? You can get at, we're going to be able to get after the passer. We're going to be able to get after him when need be. But truthfully, you want to kind of flip it on him. And what offenses do that typically put up points in a hurry is when they can't, they tighten up, right? Because you know you only get so many cuts at it, right? You only get so many drives in a game. So if you can limit their drives by two or three drives every time you play them, all of a sudden they're out of their comfort zone. You know, you don't want to go back and forth with that team. So I look at the way the Colts are built. This is a team that I feel like will win their division and potentially push for the conference. I know we're young in some areas, and I will say this. I think for us, our receiver core is going to be the key, in all honesty. And what Reggie just said, right, is what can guys do with the ball after the catch? So, you know, as we go play, if we get into those shootout style games, can we go put up those numbers? And that all goes to your receivers, right? Can they get open? Can they find the windows and the holes? And then once they catch it, what do they do with it? But I am very excited about this football team. And I think as you look at the AFC South as a whole, it's an extremely strong conference now. I mean, a division now. And as you're looking at them, when we got to go play the Titans, right, they're going to ground it, you know, ground and pound type team with the Texans. You saw Deshaun Watson last night, but I think they're limited because of Hopkins leaving. So I think from a division perspective, that's your first goal every year. Win that, you know, you're in the playoffs. And so I'm very excited about the outlook of the season.
You know, when you watch the Colts every year, you see them getting better and better and better each year. So you add on some of those additions that they're bringing, you know, with Buckner and things like that, and Pittman Jr. in the draft, and you look at them and you look at the roster and you say, man, they've gotten stronger, right? But it's all going to boil out. Jeff said everything the right way, right? He said it exactly right. But we all know it's all going to boil down to what team is healthy. We got a guy that's got to stay healthy. As they say, and Jeff knows, you can't make the club in a tub, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, we got to make sure guys are doing the little things outside of football to take care of their bodies, because we know these injuries can creep up at any time. And I think that's what, you know, if we can go in with this roster and take care of the division, AFC South first, you know, injuries is going to be the big key. You know, I mean, this roster is loaded. They have everything in the right places. Like Jeff said, it's a young roster, but, you know, they were young last year. They were young, you know, and they still, you know, got better and better as the season went on. So if guys can just lock in, take the coaching, which I know they're doing, and just focus on the task at hand, sky's the limit for this team. This team has everything. And they have it for years to come. You know, that's the great thing about it. You know, so it all starts down with the leaders of the group to get the guys to do it the right way. And I'm sure they're going to do that. But this, and when you look at this roster on paper, it's awesome. Jeff already talked about the offensive line, and we know it starts up there with those guys. I say they are the best offensive line in the league, and I think they live up to that. You know, the receivers, it is going to come down to them, because teams know about this offensive line. They know we like to run the ball. So what are these receivers going to do to counter that? So guys like T.Y. Hilton, Michael Pittman Jr., Paris Campbell, these guys have got to step up and stay healthy first, right? Stay healthy and step up and go out there and make those big plays.
We appreciate you guys so much. Thank you so much for taking the time. There is a reason that you are two of the most beloved Colts of all time. And we
Where's my helmet? Thank you.
Also, give me a gun this week.
Oh,
I got you.
Yeah.
You're ready. Get on up here. You can make it for Sunday, Reggie. Get on the plane. Guys, appreciate you so much. We hope that there is an occasion we can all get back together here soon, because it is so much fun to have y'all back in town when we are able to, when there's so many reasons to celebrate, whether it's Ring of Honor or a regular season opportunity, whatever it may be. You guys, stay safe. Thank you so much. Thank you for taking the time for all your stories, your memories, your insight, your perspective. Thank you also to General Manager Chris Ballard. A reminder, Colts season, of course, kicks off on Sunday at 1:00 in Jacksonville against divisional opponent. So tune in 1:00 on CBS, and we look forward to seeing you guys all season long.